You choose the section so that you avoid school.
So, is this function have to do anything with this quarterly electricity directive or these are the future changing operators at the right place that you can get along with?
So, that's an independent statement that one is that you have to choose the prefix and the operators in such a way that you avoid spurious poles. But then there is an independent statement that you have to make sure that the choice of prefix and the operators is consistent with factorization. Right? So both have to be satisfied.
This second
cost
that you have to actually factor comes only from the field theory?
Only from?
Yes, field theory interpretation.
Well, this is one way you can see. Otherwise, it has to do with how you compactify the supermodular space. You can start with supermodular space and try to compactify it appropriately by adding boundary modification, the boundary components. And from there, you can try to derive it. But I think the full derivation has not been given. Because the full connection between the supermodular space integral and the Victor Cheney operator has not been established. Right? It is established to a certain order. Okay? And one has a vague idea that these two are related. Right? But the full analysis has not.
That if you don't get the field as a factorized, then you get the wrong answer. At least up till now, you can see it on the field theory.
Yeah, that is from the Victor-Cheney operator viewpoint, this prescription occurs naturally in field theory. Otherwise, you have to assume it as a prescription. That whenever that some tube is becoming long, what propagates in the tube? In the NS sector, it should be minus 1, and the Ramon sector, it should be minus half or minus 3 depending on how you count it. Right? Whether you count the state that is inserted on the vortex, on the amplitude, or the state that is on the propagator. Because minus half and minus 3 are propagators. You can take that as an ad hoc prescription. Yeah, but if you start with field theory, then that choice doesn't exist. It's automatic. Right? But even in field theory, right? The way the spurious avoidance of spurious poles come, that when you define the vortex, right, then the vortex has to be defined in such a way that there is no divergence in the definition of the vortex. Right? Because vortex itself involves integration over part of the modular space, with which any operator is inserted, and you have to ensure that there is no divergence in the definition of the vortex. Right? So that gives the choice of PCO for the one particle irreducible or the elementary vortices. And then what I argue is that if you have sufficiently long stuff, right, if the vortices are such that the propagator contribution, right, that the things which are coming from joining vortices with the propagators, right, those are automatically free from spurious poles. Right. As long as you have ensured that the local coordinates that you use for defining vortices are scaled by large numbers. So that the most of the contribution comes from the elementary vortex in any given amplitude. And the rest of the Feynman diagrams basically gives contributions from the other vortex. Is this other questions? Okay, so let me then complete the mass normalization story. So let me remind you that we are looking at on-shell two-point function. Okay, these are scalars. So we are trying to calculate the normalized mass of scalars. And the, so far, what we have done is to first choose functors. We take functors nu at e equal to 0. This is the vortex of order nu at e equal to 0. Nu star at e equal to y. These are the locus of the functors. Then PCO, we have chosen V2 to be at U equal to Y and V1 to be at u not equal to 0, you have to say what, where you should put v1. Okay, what I did yesterday was to get the result when v1 is 0, okay? But that's of course a long result because that's, that doesn't satisfy this condition. And we will choose, just for simplicity, v1 to be tau and y. This to be independent of tau of but this is actually not necessary. Okay, but it just makes life a little simpler. Okay, many times drop out of that. So for example, we can choose v on equal to 0.3. And all this. Take it to a q equal to 0.3. The advantage of putting it on the real axis is that it, this point exists for all tau, right? So you don't have to change this point as you are changing your tau, right? Because eventually you have to integrate over the fundamental region, right? So if you want to choose the coordinate system in which u r is, the location of u r is tau independent, right? You can put it somewhere which always exists for the whole fundamental region. But again, as I said, this is just a convenience, it's not necessary. You can certainly relax this assumption, you have to just keep track of the answer. Okay. We also saw that the result is zero for v1 equal to 0. Okay? And this allows us to express the amplitude as a difference between the actual amplitude and the amplitude that we get for v1 equal to 0. Okay? So we write the amplitude. Integral. This integral is over of course tau tau bar y y bar. Tau bar. Okay, these things are explicitly taken out. Exponential of v tau plus bar. For the y and y bar, you have already expanded it out. Then you have tau of v1 minus tau of 0. Difference. V1 of 0. And then you have v1 bar. Tau of 1. This is the calculus on the US 1. Because yesterday you had also explicitly worked out this product, okay, it's non-singular, okay, but it has a non-singular operator expansion which you can explicitly work out. I'll use that, but for now let me keep it like this. Okay? And the other point is that here I have just taken chi of u1, okay, because I am taking u1 to be independent of tau tau bar y y, but otherwise here you have additional pieces. This is proportional to dy, dy bar, theta, and theta bar, and hence this expression will not apply.
The
term of del psi part. Pardon? The del psi part. Exactly, the del psi part will come. It depends on y bar. Now there is an immediate simplification for this once you have chosen this to be independent of tau, tau bar as well. Because now you see that from this exponential, you need a d tau d tau, right? Because you are supposed to integrate over tau tau. So the only term that contributes from this exponential is d tau bar, d tau s d tau bar. Okay, you have to pick this term in the next class. So now we are going to manipulate this, okay? And the goal is to try to manipulate it to write as a total derivative, okay? So that we can get express the result just as a boundary. So let's look at this combination what we have. This one is BIS inverted part. This is in the minus one picture. Unintegrated part is important. This is BIS inverted by construction. So I can write this as integral over some contour, let's call it C bar dy 0 d of y plus dy bar 0 d y bar. So I shouldn't say dy, let's call it dy. And give you the general coordinate of dy. So maybe I should call it something. Let's call it here, two here. The angle moves. This is a BIS. And then I replace this by xi of V1 minus xi of 0 V1. This contour C bar encloses 0 and 2. So, 0 and V1. So the picture is here we have 0, here we have V1. We pick some contour that encloses this, but it doesn't enclose all any of the other intersections. Okay, so here we have Y, okay. Then we have the UI and UI bar integral, so this is UI, UI bar. And then there are some beta and beta integrals. Okay, it doesn't enclose any of those. So this is can be represented as this. Okay, because chi is qb with psi. Okay, so chi of u1 minus chi of 0 is qb with. So this it will pick up from here, the residue is chi of u1 minus chi of 0. And from here there is no residue because this BIS is invariant. Okay, so the fact that this contour is enclosing u of 0 is it. So what we do now, let me draw our torus. Okay, this is our torus, right? So you know we expand this out. So the circle, you just expand it out to make it as an integral like this. Okay, I'll answer boundary of the parallelogram. But then of course we know that this is a perfectly good operator, JB of U, so it's periodic, it satisfies the right periodicity property of that it's supposed to do on the torus. So the integral around this will cancel the integral around this, and integral around this will cancel the integral around this. Okay. So there is a contribution from this boundary, right? This is if you are single, you can actually shrink it to a point on the torus. Okay, by expanding it out. Even though the torus is topologically non-trivial, right? Well, sphere of course it's easy. Okay? When a sphere in your circle, you can always wrap it around and make it 0. Okay? Here, it's not topologically trivial, so this cannot be really shrunk to 0, but there are, because of the periodicity, things can be cancelled. Okay? So it's as good as saying that you can send it to 0. Why? But in that process, it is going to pick up contributions from the residues. Now here we have chi of y mu star y, these are both BIS invariant. Okay, so there is a residue from here. But there will be residues from these as well as from this. These as well as from this beta of beta. Okay. This is clear. So let's pick one particular residue from BIS. Okay, then that will give you an idea of what. Residue from UI. what is UI? UI is integral around the C2 contour. C2 contour is this. This one. Right? This is, you can call this C2 prime, but it's the same contour in a sense. But anyway, you are focusing on UI. Okay? So it's integral C2. And then you have a V of U. So the residue JB with B, that OP has a single pole which is proportional to P, right? Because QB anti-commutator of B is T. So the residue, after you have taken the residue at U, right, this is replaced by integral over C2 T of U. And this is enclosing the point one. Okay. I mean, you could in principle take this contour outside this. You have taken to be overlapping. It doesn't matter because TU with DY bar has no OP area. Right? Because this is purely anti-holomorphic. Okay, so if this contour can be just, if it's, if we place this DY by PY, right, which is the integral of P, whether you take it outside or inside that sort of thing, right? You really become the residue. Now, to find the residue from this, you have to use the fact that both chi y and mu star y are dimension 0 parameters. Okay? So, chi y, mu star y is also a dimension 0 parameter. Yes.
Mu 0 and mu star, they are, since they are physical action of 2d on the 0.
Yes.
2d on chi y is also 0.
That's right.
So, only dy, 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 but these are.
And the beta will cover that. So those are the residues which you have to worry about. Right? So I have already picked the residue from V1 which is given by this. Okay? Now I have to evaluate this integral. Right? And what I am saying is to evaluate this integral, I have to find out how as a function of u it behaves near y, because this integration contour is enclosing y. Right? So you have to basically pick the single pole contribution from y. And just by the fact that chi y mu star y, chi y is a dimension 0 primary, this is a dimension 0 primary, and the product is non-singular, so the product is also a dimension 0 primary. Okay, we have already seen that the product is non-singular. So P of U, chi y mu star y, is just 1 over u minus y, L y, of chi y mu star y. This is a standard CFTO. Okay, dimension 0 primary, so no 1 over u minus y square contribution, 1 over u minus y contribution. So this, and so the residue after you have evaluated this, you just get del y of I y mu star y. And now you see that nothing else in this expression depends on y. Okay? This is xi of u1 minus xi of 0, right? This u1 by f is independent of y. Okay? These are just some contours, contour integrals along these are, again, we don't directly depend on y. So basically, this del del y comes outside the whole integral. Okay? So let me write that first expression, then here. So we get integral tau bar. Again, let me emphasize that I have not keeping track of the normalizations, but this you can easily fix by going to that procedure. And then real y of d tau bar. Psi 1 minus psi 0 mu 0 dy bar, nothing is changed here. Dy bar Okay, this is one of the terms, this is the term that you get from the residue at from the commutator of QE with V1, from the antimatter to V1. Is clear?
Experiment
del
y of this plus
del
y bar.
Exactly. But del, because q u bar, u y bar will become the del y bar, right? So the next one will be minus del y bar of p dot is I of 1 minus I of 0. V of 0. This turns b y. Okay, this minus sign comes because QB has to go through the y ones, right? Or the negative sign is minus. Because in one, QB has to go through one of these. Okay, so then there are terms involving delta and delta bar. These are coming from beta 1, beta 1. Okay, one can give a similar argument to show that when you take a QB beta 1 commutator, right, you get an integral of t along that circle. So that, okay, effect of that is basically generate del delta. Okay, it requires a little more effort, but that's equal to. Okay, that if you insert t, right, act on this circle. See, the only way that this transition function, say we use local coordinates in various patches, right? And the only place where tau appeared in the transition function is across this side, across this part, right? Because W4 was W3 minus tau. Okay? And what we can show is that if you can insert a t integral along this circle, if you replace a v integral by t integral, that basically generates a tau derivative. And similarly, a tau bar derivative if you replace the v bar integral by the t bar integral. Okay, that's the origin of these delta and delta bar. Okay, again, this is just a property of quantum effect here. Is this clear? So from this we see that each of these can be expressed as boundary terms because they are total derivatives. They are integrating over tau as well, tau bar as well as y bar. So these are all boundary terms. And what one can show for that is that for this particular case, the boundary terms that come from tau and tau bar integral, they actually vanish. Okay, they and the physical reason for this is that the tau and tau bar integration gives you boundary terms which are from the non-separating type degeneration. Right? The boundary in the tau bar integration region is the tau goes to I infinity region. Right? Tau goes to I infinity region is when the handle is becoming long. Right? It's not a separating type degeneration. And typically one finds that all non-separating type degenerations do not contribute to boundary terms. Okay? So these values. Okay, I'll not describe too much of this, but we'll just take this for granted and proceed. Okay, so the why is the boundary term coming from these? Is this clear? So now we try to write down the expressions for mu as well as chi y. So let me remind you again that mu of 0 was c bar c p into chi p of x. Okay, mu was the dimension half 1 diagram. And you have all noted that for doing this calculation, you can set k equal to 0, where everything depends on k square, right? This all correlation constant. And because and k cannot contract for anything else, there's no k dot epsilon, right? Because that's the epsilon, there's not a vector. So setting k square equal to 0 basically means that you can set k equal to 0. Okay, you don't lose anything. So k equal to 0, this is c bar c. I y, mu star y, is c d q star. Okay. Let me remind you again that the utility star is what you get by taking the OP of EF with V star and picking up a leading contribution. This is a dimension 1-1 prime. Primary of conformal algebra, but not of the square conformal algebra. This is what appears in a zero vector potential. Okay, so for example, if you are dealing with graviton, V star will be like psi mu del bar x mu. E tilde star will be like psi del x mu del bar x. Okay? This going from V star to V tilde star is like converting psi mu to del x del bar x mu. Or psi mu to del x mu. But in case here, of course, these are both primary is coming from the internal part of the scale. Because they are scalar part. Now, the effect of by bar, we have said this to just raise the c bar, and it removes the c bar. So this is c bar this time. No, I think that this is. I think this is c bar c. Just look at the. Formula again, c bar c, and then this is 1 quarter c bar.
Yeah.
So this is the form of the of pi by this. Okay, now we are supposed to apply either bi or bi bar, right? Because here you have to calculate bi bar on this, here you have to calculate bi on this. And bi and bi bar, as you have seen, just remove the c bar and c. So BY bar and R1 V star y. This gives you, we just remove the C bar. It gives you C V tilde star minus 1 quarter beta V phi V star. Okay, this is what I had in there. And BY on chi y. Okay, this will remove the C. So it removes the C from here, there is a C here, so it just gives this. So this gives you minus C bar. So now the idea is you have to basically substitute these there and evaluate. But now you see that most of the terms if I drop. Because see here we have a xi v or minus xi, right? We are calculating this amplitude in a small interval. So the only way you can get a non-zero result from the torus is to have an eta. Okay? If you didn't have an eta, then the psi charge is not positive. Okay? So this means that the only way you can have a non-zero contribution is if this or this has an eta. Now this one has an eta, there's a second term. This one doesn't have an eta. So this term doesn't contribute at all. Okay? This term would contribute. As we have said, the nu doesn't have any eta, right? Nu is here. So nu has no xi on it. So I again missed out something from here. Okay. Here this would have been equal to minus pi. Okay. Okay, this is the minus 1. Right here, the minus pi has gone from the pi has been. So then, this gives the amplitude to your form d tau h, d tau bar, and del y. The first term is the only one which has contribution dy, dy bar, d tau bar. So now we can do this y into the explicitly and write it as a boundary term. Okay, we'll worry about what possible boundaries are there, but this I can just write up to normal as an integral d tau h. Let me write this as a d tau tau bar integral, of course, is clear, it's also the fundamental equation. Y integral runs over the boundary. Okay, we will see what the boundary means. Sorry, y1, because y is, you have to put y at the boundary, right? It's dy del y, right? So that you integrate out. So then the y bar integral is here, dy bar. And then we have d tau bar. Now I'm going to write everything explicitly, psi of u1 minus psi of 0. Or C, E minus pi, B, 0, and E bar, B, 5, B, 4.
Minus
1
fourth is
the
normal
equation. Yeah, minus 1 fourth, right? Minus 1 fourth, okay, but I'm not kept that as normal as anyway, right? So that's a minus 1 fourth. Is this clear? Okay. So the boundary, okay, just to be on the safe side, we can take the boundary to wherever this integral becomes illiquid. Right? We have to cut out a small, so in order to define this integral, okay, whenever it becomes, it encounters a singularity, you have to cut out a small circle and do this integral. Okay, that's what I mean by the boundary. So the boundary could be circle around y equal to v and circle around y. Okay, because that's where as function of y there can be singularity. Okay, because you see at y equal to v1, at y equal to v1, the zeta, eta times psi of v1 has a 1 over y minus v1 kind of singularity. At y equal to 0, there is a more complicated singularity because there are many poles and zeros, right? So if you understand. You just pat out small circles, these are small circles. And carry out something. Now, the contribution from the boundary around y equal to v1, so you can easily see that this is 0, so let's sort this out first. So near v1, this goes as 1 over 1 minus v1, right? Because eta of y times I of v1. And so you are integrating dy bar over y minus v1. And let's suppose that you are integrating on over a circle y minus mod y minus v1 into the epsilon. Okay? You cut out a small circle around the boundary and integrate. So you can write y minus v1 as epsilon into the I theta. Okay? So y bar minus v1 is epsilon is real, say, v minus I theta. So this integral then goes as epsilon into the I theta into the minus I theta divided by epsilon into the I theta, which is into the minus 2 I theta d theta, and this is a 0 by phase. Because the integral dy bar over y minus v1 is actually 0. Is this clear? Okay, and the limit epsilon goes to 0, nothing else contributes. Right? Everything else will be over epsilon g. So it's just by phase integral. Okay. Now, this also says what kind of term we really need. Okay? Because we have to. Even for y equal to 0. Right? Because what we need is that after cancelling the powers of y and y bar, if you have y bar, it's okay. Right? Y bar just phase is cancelled. Right? But besides that, there should be an uncancelled phase which is of the same, which is the same as that of y bar. Right? So for example, dy bar over y bar would give a non-zero contribution. Okay? Dy bar over y bar square will also give a non-zero contribution. Because y bar is has no phase. But dy bar over y, dy bar over y bar square, this would not give contribution. Is that clear? Right? Because the phases will cancel. Right? Once you put a small circle and carry out the integral, the phases will cancel. So here you are looking for the contribution of the form dy bar over y bar. Right? Or more generally, dy bar over y bar times yy bar to the power of. For any
In this case, this is just Cauchy's theorem.
Yes, in this case, it's just Cauchy's theorem. Because here, it's completely anti-analytic. In general, it will be a function of y and y bar, right? You have to be a little more. Right? But in fact, the work is not much, as you see. Okay, so this is what I'm going to use. So let's do this. So now we have to look at y near 0. Okay? Beyond the boundary doesn't give any contribution, so we have to now look at the boundary near y equal to 0. So y goes to 0. So here some things we can easily work out. So first you see that e to the 5, e to the minus 5 e to the 5. E to the 5 of y. Minus 5 of 0 goes as 1 plus 5 of 0. In eta of y, psi of 0, we have y inverse plus I of 0. So this product, when you take the two together, there's only a power of 1. There are 1 plus star. So now we are left with V star of y is V of psi. That's the part that we have to worry about, right? So V star of y times V of 0. So leading term, if you recall, we have written down. This is y times y bar square. Okay, we are these are conjugate operators in the matter CFT. This is dimension half, one half, one half. So look at the product. You get y bar square y. Okay, this is 2 times half, this is 2 times 1. So this is a potential delta, right? Because this has a correct form. So you need y bar over y bar. And there is a 1 over y bar. Okay, so this is, this could contribute. Okay, in fact, if this did contribute, it will even diverge, right? Because when you put 1 over epsilon, right, this gives you epsilon cube in the denominator, there is epsilon in the numerator, right, from the dy by. But the point is that the coefficient of this is identity, right? Okay. So you apply it here. Okay, you take the product. You get that divergent piece, but the product coefficient is identity. So what you get basically is the all the size etc. have gone, right? Only C bar C is left here, DB is left here, and identity. That's just a porous partition feature. Right? Because in the matter sector there's nothing. And that we know by supersymmetry is zero. Porous partition function is zero simply because the bosons and fermions cancel. At 3 level, the bosons and fermions come in equal and opposite pairs. So here, it's sensitive, it's basically trace of e to the minus beta x times minus 1 to the other. And that is 0 simply because at 3 level, the bosons and fermions come in pairs. So the fact that the theory has supersymmetry at 3 level, right, is enough to guarantee that this term doesn't work.
Sorry, this, how does supersymmetry at 3 level show that?
Because this is one loop partition function on the torus, right? So this you can think of as trace of e to the 2 pi I tau L naught minus 2 pi I tau by L naught part.
Oh, and the spectrum is 3 level, that's the reason.
Yeah, the spectrum are 3 level because this traces over the 3 level spectrum.
So that is, I see.
So that basically the boson and fermion cancel.
Because it doesn't matter for the solar system.
Exactly. And then the minus 1 to be left. Okay, this is just the fact that the fermion loops are an extra minus A. Right? So here the fermion is propagating in the loop. This is the space time fermion. Now I should add that here I have taken a very specific procedure for doing the calculation by subtracting of something which you shouldn't have done. Right? And then doing this. But in principle, you, of course, you don't have to do that. Right? You can just do the calculation by putting the pictures in your apartment and the right torus and try to value. Okay, it just makes life simpler here because it becomes a total derivative. manifest it, and then so you can just regard this as a boundary. Okay, but it is certainly not necessary. Okay, the actual calculation can be done without making any error at any stage. Okay? You have to make an error and then you are back. You are finding the error that you get. So this is gone. Okay, this doesn't contribute. Now it turns out that just from the control field theory, what identities, you can work out some other terms in this expansion. Okay, so let me write it down. So the first was 1 over y bar square times identity. Then there is a term of the form 1 over y bar times g plus 1 over y bar square times j bar plus 1 over y bar times j bar. Okay, there are coefficients here, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and these are actually calculable coefficients. Okay, these coefficients can be calculated from known g and j bar charges. Okay, so the way it works is that if you know the j charge of these, okay, in fact I don't remember if I told that this carries j charge 1, this carries j charge minus 1. Okay, for j bar charge, this carries 2, this carries minus 2. So that means that it determines the singular part of the j nu op and j nu star op and so on. Okay. And then you have to look for an appropriate three-point function, okay, like j nu star three-point function. You can evaluate it in two ways. One is that you first take the OP of J with nu, okay, and then compute it. Or you first take the OP of nu with nu star and then compute it. These two ways of different computing basically gives a conditional alpha, which gives alpha. Similarly for alpha 2 and alpha 3. Okay, so these are calculable. So let's look at this expansion. So let's look at this term, J. Now, first you see that it doesn't have right part, right? This is equal part of y and y bar, so the phase integral and then okay, but let's worry about that later. First, let's see what this will contribute, right? Suppose you have inserted a J. Insert a J, then basically what we're trying to calculate is beta of one C bar C J R C. Okay, now it's one of the partition function, you have inserted the J. Is clear? Okay, because you are putting up the J part. Now, J is the only matter sector prime, right? By matter sector operator. Everything else is closed. So, by transition impedance of the torus, you can actually put J anywhere that you like. Okay, it gives the same result. Because in the matter sector by itself, nothing can depend on Y because that's the only one matter sector operator you are inserting on the torus. So, this J actually you can replace by integral along the A cycle of J. Okay, a cycle is this cycle. Okay. So now again, you can give it an interpretation in terms of a trace. So what it is calculating is trace of e 2 pi I tau n naught minus e pi I tau bar in the bar then J0 minus one. So you are not calculating a trace, you are calculating a trace weighted by J0 charge. And that's what it means. Now it turns out that J0 has eigenvalue, plus 1 on the positive chiral, on the chiral quantitative states, and the eigenvalue minus 1 on the anti-chiral quantitative states. And in the spectrum, there are equal number of chiral and anti-chiral quantitatives. Because once you have a chiral quantitative, its CPT conjugate is an anti-chiral. Given phi, phi star, you can think of as an anti-chiral. So, because of this, so you insert J0 in the place, again it cancels. So this is actually also 0. Because J0 charges are paired. J0 charges paired into plus and minus I get value. Okay, that's from the CPT invariance. So okay, in low energy description, it basically translates to the fact that you have equal number of chiral and anti-chiral quantities. If you don't worry about the charge. Even if it's a chiral quantity at phi, you can always think of phi star as an anti-chiral
quantity. What you argue is that this is on the progress of one-point function of a purely holomorphic operator, so it's 0. Because you need one holomorphic, one anti-holomorphic to freeze the U1 times U1 positions. Like on the sphere.
Okay, yeah. The point is that on because of the torus, this is a finite volume integral.
Right?
Yeah, integration over the A cycle, but that doesn't mean zero. Right? See, what happens here is that you just get a finite.
U1 times U1.
Exactly. Right? So it's a finite volume, you just divide out by the volume. And unlike in the case of a sphere, right, where you get the ascent toward volume and hence you get zero. That doesn't happen on the torus. Okay. So this is also zero. Then look at J bar. Okay. Again, first of all, it doesn't have a right phase. Okay, so from that this perspective it will be zero anyway, ui bar over y bar square. But we can also look at the coefficients. So you have J bar by the same argument, you can replace it by J bar square. So J bar 0, what does it count? It counts the U1 charge. Right? U1, you have a U1 gauge, but it just counts the U1 charge carries by the states. Right? So you are calculating trace over all the states weighted by the U1 charge. And again by CPT, you have always equal number of states with positive and negative U1 charge. Right? If phi carries U1 charge plus 1, phi star will carry U1 charge minus 1. Right? Every state is paired. This is okay. So by that argument, this is also 0. So this doesn't contribute. This doesn't contribute. So now let's look at this one. This one you see you have dy bar over y bar. So this could contribute, right? If the coefficient is non-zero, this would contribute because you have dy bar over y bar, right, which is certainly non-zero. So for this, we are replacing here by jj bar, right? So by the same argument, you can replace this by j0, j0 bar. Right? Because j can be integrated independently and j bar can be integrated independently. J0, j0 bar. So now we are counting not the U1 charge, nor whether the j0 charge, but you are counting, you are taking the trace weighted by the product of j0 charge and j0 bar charge. Okay? So you take a product of U1 charge and whether it's chiral or anti-chiral. And now CPT doesn't prevent it from being non-zero. Because we know that a chiral multiplier is positive, given a chiral multiplier with positive charge, there will be an anti-chiral multiplier with negative charge. Right? But given a chiral multiplier with positive charge, there need not be an anti-chiral multiplier with the same charge. Okay, in general that is not true. If the theory is non-chiral, it is true. Right? And in which case this will vanish. But in theory, which are chiral, and there are these theories are typically chiral, when you take a solid heterotic on chiral block, there you can get a non-zero contribution, okay, from this JJ bar. And that non-zero contribution, in fact, gets contribution only for the massless states. Okay, this kind of lack of pairing, right, can happen only in the massless state. Okay, once you have massive states, then you can show that the J charges are separately paired and J bar charges are separately paired. So you cannot get any contribution. So net option of this
cases which the theories are chiral lucid, this will cancel. Non-chiral, this will cancel.
Exactly. Your theory is non-chiral, if that a massless set, right? It's non-chiral, that means that for every charged state of positive chirality, there is also a state of negative chirality. Okay? So chiral multipliers and anti-chiral multipliers appear for a fixed charge. Okay? And in that case, the JJ bar will cancel because you fix J bar, take positive J and negative J, okay? They will obviously give an opposite contribution to J. So for non-chiral theories, this will cancel. Okay? But typically, heterotic strength from chiral or chiral theories, then you don't get cancelled. Okay. For non-chiral theory, also the animal is cancelled, the U1 animal is cancelled, right? So everything is consistent. Right? So what this is saying that whenever there is U1 anomaly, there is also a possibility of getting an observed result. Okay. So effectively what we get is the following.
Is this given by
it's, yeah, I think it's eventually given by proportional order characteristics. That's it. So if the order character is 0, then this is certainly 0. Okay. If the order character is not 0, it may still happen that by some accident it vanishes. Okay, because depending on the details of the spectrum. Exactly. But it's not directly. So if the order character is 0, then there is point value is 0, right? It's just there are always equal number of chiral. So then the result is that you get the proportional d tau with d tau bar. U I bar over y bar, which you just count for 1. D tau bar.
And then c bar
c
g bar c. Higher order terms in the other two OT expansions don't.
Yeah, so you can take higher order terms for this OP expansion,
right? Yeah,
they will combine with these.
But not with this, they don't give anything.
These are not going to give anything for the matter sector, right? Because they are purely host sector.
So the J bar argument will go.
Exactly. So this argument, which is based on the matter sector, will
go. Even though this epsilon phase argument could have failed.
Exactly. So you could have killed the phase anomaly, for example, here, right? You could have picked a Y bar or a Y bar term from this OP.
Well,
y bar term is not the
idea. No, but the J one, you could have picked a y squared term.
Yeah, you could have picked a y squared term and tried to cancel it,
but the J argument.
Yeah, the J argument basically means. Okay, then each of these are separately 0 but not the other idea. In the matter sector. So then the mass square eventually, you can show its proportional. And now, if you recall, okay, when we did the analysis of the supersymmetric breaking, then we carried out two tests of supersymmetric breaking, okay, and there we arrived at precisely this expression. Right? When we tried to test whether supersymmetric is broken or not, we found that if this is non-zero, then supersymmetric is broken. If this is zero, supersymmetric is unbroken. So it's exactly the same coefficient that appeared in the expression for the in test of supersymmetric breaking also appears here. And I should say that here, of course, I'm not very careful about the normalization, but you can work out the normalization at every stage carefully. And you can determine whether this is positive or negative. And in all the examples that have been studied, these terms have to be always negative, okay? Which means that the mass square is negative, and hence the field becomes active. All left-right symmetric compactification, you can show this is always. If the theory is not left-right symmetric, if you don't identify the spin connection with gauge connection, then of course you have to do the analysis explicitly. Whatever people have done the analysis, it turns out to be true that the mass square is negative. But there's no general proof that it will always come down to negative.
If it turns out to be positive, then supersymmetric is broken.
Then supersymmetric is broken. Then there's no other shift.
So pi square pi plus constant goes.
Exactly. But negative mass square means here we have 5 star 5 minus 2y 5 star 1 minus some kg square. And now we can make this value by switching on 5 star 5. And because k is positive, there is minus sign. So here the solution can be explored. But in other case, at the pi equal to 0 vacuum, right? That's the quadratic vacuum. At the quadratic vacuum, Suzy is also. Okay? That you see from the low energy effective field theory description, that the Suzy should be broken because the vacuum energy is non-zero. Okay? You also saw last time in the because you performed a direct test of Suzy plane, right? That two point function that I calculated earlier was a direct test of whether Suzy is broken or not. Okay. Yeah, you saw that you have exactly the same expression. Okay, so Suzy is broken as long as this is non-zero. But you can also see it from the calculation that you have done here. Okay. And the argument is kind of very simple. It goes as follows.
So the Euler character is possible that Suzy is still unbroken.
Yes, if the Euler character is zero, then it's possible that in fact then it is true that Suzy will remain unbroken. That because this coefficient is zero.
Not beyond one loop.
I think beyond one loop there are some arguments why Suzy should be broken, but I don't know how strong those arguments.
Unbroken. Euler character is zero.
Yeah, the Euler character is zero, then Suzy is unbroken at one loop. And I think then there is a general argument that it cannot be broken at hard loops.
All loops.
Two hard loops, yes. Non-quadratic effects can still break it. Right? But I think, but that argument is based on a low energy effective field. Right? I don't think there is a stringy argument which says that this cannot be broken. That's it. It can still be that the stringy effects could break it. So let's see how we can see that the supersymmetry mass is broken. So we see that spiral mass square is of order Ts square. Then at the bottom of it. Now, if this is negative, then obviously the supersymmetric has to be broken because you cannot have a vacuolic particle in a supersymmetric vacuum. Okay? Because supersymmetric vacuum in any direction will go, it has to, the potential has to rise. So you cannot have a vacuolic particle in a supersymmetric vacuum, so supersymmetric has to be broken. But suppose it was positive. Okay? Suppose you have found some theory where m square is a part of t square, that the coefficient is positive. Then would it happen that it's actually supersymmetric? Right? Maybe the low energy field theory is not giving us the right insight. The way you can see that it still cannot be a supersymmetric vacuum is the following. That m square of order ts square means m of order ts. Right? So this means that if the supersymmetry is to be unbroken, then its formulaic partner, the formulaic partner of these layers, must get a mass of order ts. Now for bosons, when you do a loop calculation, okay, you always calculate m square. Right? For fermions, when you do loop calculation, to say the normalized mass of the fermion, you calculate m. Okay, because m is what appears in the fermion action. Right? So if the fermion did appear a mass at one loop, that mass would be of order g square. Right? It's impossible in a perturbation theory without doing some shift of fields to get an order GS contribution to the mass of a fermion. Okay. So it's impossible that supersymmetry can be restored. Okay, the supersymmetry can be unbroken in this vacuum. Because there is no way that you can get an order GS contribution to your fermion mass. It's either vanishing at one loop, in which case it's zero, or if it's non-zero, it's an order GS. No, so this shows that even if you didn't do the previous calculation, right, the direct calculation which shows the supersymmetry is broken, just from the fact that the scalar acquires a mass square of order g square, tells you that the supersymmetry has to be broken. Right, because there is no other formula that can get a mass square of space.
So this argument is only follow.
This argument, when you want, okay, once it has been broken at one loop, it will continue to be broken because you can never get an order gs at higher order. So at a part of the vacuum, it shows that the supersymmetry is broken to area of part of the But this argument doesn't hold for the shifted vacuum that we have been talking about, because there you can, you give the string field the vacuum expectation of order gs. And that could generate a continual mass of order gs. Right? There, the expansion is no longer in part of gs square, but in part of gs. Right? And that can restore supersymmetry.
That's why
it's
a non-partitive
vacuum. Yeah. The point is, one should call it purely, really non-partitive, because it can be treated in partitive. Right? It's just that you have to change your partitive expansion from the gs square expansion to a gs expansion. Right? That's the difference. It's still possible. Otherwise, you couldn't have done any of this. Right? I mean, if it's really non-partitive, right? We have the way we have set up strength field theory techniques, it still tells you how to calculate 20 minimum given order in partitive. Right?
I'm saying that this GS contribution doesn't come directly from the
usually one shift partitive. Okay. Now I should just say, which I have this calculation on that too, that as you have seen that from the effective field for analysis, so we can also see that at two loop, the delay term will get a non-zero character. Okay? Because at two loop order, okay, there is a k square gs to the 4 contributing to the vacuum energy density. And given that gs knows about the delay term, see, there is a 1 over gs square term, right? So at one loop, you don't see, so the vacuum energy density contribution is square, right? So the at two loop, you will first see that there is a delay term, because there is a term in the effective action of the form non-zero, something non-zero times e to the minus, e to the 2 phi, right? And hence the del del phi, the equation of motion will not be satisfied, right? That's what I mean by the delay term being that pole. So this again you can try to directly calculate using the string theory techniques. Okay. To calculate that pole, you basically use the string field theory technique that I have described. What one means by that being that pole. Okay. Then you try to solve the equation iteratively and you find that there is an obstruction. That's all. And you will find that there will be an obstruction to solving the data. And again one can explicitly calculate the coefficient of that obstruction and verify that it agrees with what this low energy effective field theory predicts. Because, see, there will be one relationship between the mass square, the renormalized mass square that you get, because both are controlled by the same coefficient k, right? The renormalized mass square of the scalar is controlled by k, and the delay on back pole is controlled by k square, right? So, the two better agree. And if you go through the calculation carefully, you find that indeed there are those two agree. Okay? And their result is consistent with the low energy effective field theory. But again, there, to calculate the tadpole, it's easier to first make a wrong assignment of picture changing operator, which makes the results vanish. And then you correct for it by calculating the difference between the right assignment and the wrong assignment. Okay, and you find that then the result analysis becomes easier. Then instead of having to calculate actually two loop amplitude, it becomes a product of two one-loop amplitudes, okay, which are much easier to calculate. Okay, and that vector also manifests that the contribution comes as k square. Okay? Each of those one loop amplitude gives you k, and that's how you get the k square.
So suppose this non-prescription is a non-zero answer, might still be around
non-zero. Yeah, it could be. It could be a non-zero answer, then it doesn't help very much. Unless you can actually calculate a non-zero answer easily.
We can always do this thing. Difference between those two prescriptions and infinity is coefficient.
Well, in that case, if it gives a non-zero answer, right, then the difference should not give you this coefficient. The difference plus the non-zero answer should give you this coefficient. Okay? Well, this coefficient is supposed to be the full answer, right, for the data. Okay? But a general, feature seems to be, okay, again, I don't know if there is a deeper understanding. The general feature seems to be that the superstring breaking effects are really sensitive to having that picture changing operator in the right places. That if you put the picture changing operator in the wrong place, right, you may be led to the conclusion that there is no superstring breaking. Okay, that everything is perfectly fine. Okay. As you saw here, that if you have put the picture changing operator in the wrong place, you will get this coefficient to be zero. And the same thing happens for the electron dipole. If you put it on the wrong place, you find that the electron dipole is vanishing. But then what you find is that when you put it in the right place, you precisely recover the answer that is compatible with the correct answer that you got for the one mass formalization. Is this clear? Okay, so let me then begin with the next topic and I'll finish tomorrow. Which is to, now we really want to find the shifted dipole, right, by in string field theory, and the idea is that once you can systematically see how to find the shifted vacuum, then using string field theory you can compute of amplitudes in the shifted dipole. Okay. For example, suppose you are interested in calculating the 4 graviton amplitude, the full analog of the Hertzian amplitudes, okay, but in the shifted dipole. Okay, how do you calculate, right? From the low energy effective field theory description, there is no way to do that operation, right? Because here you have already integrated on the massive fields, you have expanded in derivatives, right? So you cannot recover the energy amplitude from the effective field, right? But you may be interested in calculating the 4 graviton amplitude in the shifted vacuum, but without making any low energy approximation. If we can implement it in string field theory, then the procedure is quite straightforward. Right? We know how to compute the S by bits from string field theory, not only in the original background but also in the shifted background. So you want to see how we can see this here, the possibility that you can get a non-zero vacuum for phi star phi upon GS or GS square from a string field theory analysis, okay, systematically looking for solutions. Is this question clear? No, it then is broken. If you don't find a solution for the shifted vacuum, and if you have already found here that in the first argument superstring is broken, here this is the mass square is also
broken. This has to also broken. At one time, independently, the superstring is broken.
No. So, there the part is we are trying to now look for a solution that tells us there exists a shifted vacuum. Right? We know from the insight into from the low energy field theory that there should exist a shifted vacuum. But we want to say, first of all, verify it by using the string field theory analysis. And the advantage is that if we can find this, the solution in string field theory to any given order in GS, then you can use that solution to compute scattering amplitudes without taking low energy approximation. Like you can calculate higher energy scattering amplitude to any given order. Okay. So let me just give a basic outline of what you want, how you proceed. Okay. So the outline is exactly what I had described earlier, that you have to solve for the thing iteratively. Okay? So you have to solve the equations of motion iteratively. So the equation of motion is ub psi is minus psi over mu equal to infinity. And you take psi k to be the solution to order t gets to be k. Solution by to order t. Now let's see what kind of solution are you looking for. You are looking for a solution where phi you will get a vacuum exception, right? And the phase is of course ambiguous, right? Either phi, real part of phi may get a vacuum exception value, or imaginary part may get a vacuum exception value, or something else, right? Mod phi is proportional to Gs, that's all you want. But let's say that you want to look for a solution where the real part of phi gets a vacuum exception. Okay? So then we start with a seed solution, psi 1 as beta Gs, where u r, my vacuum exception is 1 over u 2, u plus u psi. And u r as usual is the state of order correspondence between u r and u r. So you see that this is not the most general seed solution you could have written down. You could have, to read this order, you could have taken any linear combination of dimension zero brackets. Because all of them will be added by Q. Right? So at this order, to order Gs, the right hand side doesn't contribute. Right? These are of order Gs square. Okay, that you have. So in this order, you have to just take the Qd psi 1 as 0. And indeed, that is true. We satisfy the equation of this order. Okay, so Qb psi 1 is order Gs square. That's all you need. Okay, in this case, in practice, it's exactly 0. Beta is right now an unknown constant. So this is the magnitude of the beta, all the way, right, that you have to switch off. So now let's move on to next order. UV sign. So now the right hand side has to be kept accurately up to order Gs square. Right? Because psi 2 has to be correct up to order Gs square. Right? So you can make errors of order Gs cube but not of order Gs square. So let's see what are the order Gs square contributions from the right hand side. So the first order Gs square contribution can come by picking, let me write, minus half. Psi 1 square. This is the g equal to 0 one. Right? Because if you take g equal to 0, then less than n equal to 2, here the power n less than equal to 3 doesn't contribute. Right? And after that, these 2. So psi 1 square, this is our g square. So what other contribution can there be? Yes, order g square. Yes? No, I am just calculating the right hand side, right, of this. So one is psi 1 psi 1, right? That is one order g square, because psi 1 is of order gs. Can there be anything else?
G equal to 1.
G equal to 1 contribution is there. So minus this is non-zero, right? At this is 0 at g equal to 0. But at g equal to 1, this is just one part function, right? This is defined by saying that the matrix element with any state A is just the curly bracket of A. So these are the only two part functions. That's all it is. So you can write this So let me either put the g square factor explicitly, because that's the convention you have been following. Right? That this is gs to the 2g times. Yes. So I can write this as g square times minus half theta square. We want to extend it to next order, or not next order, we have to solve this. But as we discussed, that to be able to solve this, there is a consistency condition. And the consistency condition comes from the fact that the matrix element of this, with any physical state, is identical to 0. Right? So that right hand side will also satisfy that condition. If it's realistic, if it's pure gauge, then also the matrix element is identical to 0. But that follows from the fact that the QB on this is automatically GSQ, right? That consistency condition you have already checked. So the only consistency condition that you have to check is that the matrix element of this with the physical state is 0. Right? So P C0 minus QB psi 2 is automatically 0. This implies that P C0 minus times this okay. You can expand it out, and this is minus half beta square P mu r mu r 0 minus P is a body shock for this thing. This has to be true. Has to be true. Has to hold for every physical state. Here there are various possibilities. One is that these are individually zeros for every physical state. In which case you can proceed without putting any constant on beta. Right? Because that doesn't say anything about beta. Second possibility is that this has no solution, that this is non-zero, and there's no beta for the fact.
Should be order
GSQ
or should be
0? Should be order GSQ. Should be order GSQ. Okay. But the point is that because here all the factors of GS have been stripped off anyway, okay. So there is no GS anywhere on this side anyway, right? So it has to be 0. So in fact, it's not order GSQ, it's order GS because GS square I stripped off already, right? But this is, I mean, there's no GS on this stack, so it has to be really 0. Is this clear? Okay. So there are many P's here, right? And this has to be true for all P's. Now it turns out that in this case, both of these terms vanish for all P. Okay? This holds identity. Okay. So you can proceed. Okay. All the consistency conditions are satisfied without putting any constant on it. Okay. We can proceed to the next one. So that means the solution exists to this order. To order j squared, there is an abstraction to find any solution.
Holds identically means?
Meaning it's true for all. Then individually, this is 0 and this is 0 for all physical states. Okay, that's what I mean. Is this, yeah?
Why it is 0 individual for all individual terms?
Why is it 0? Well, you have to calculate. I mean, for this model, it's not for every string compact. Right? But for this class of string compact configurations, using the fact that this new R, right? Guy is new plus new star. This guy is, for example, the U1 charge 2, this guy is U1 charge minus 2. Okay. So you have to use that information, okay, to show that there is no P for which this case is non zero. Yeah, and similarly, there is no, this will mean that there is a one loop pattern, right? And that again you can show using general argument that for this particular case, there is no one loop pattern. Okay. This has to do with the fact that the supersymmetry is unbroken at tree level. So once supersymmetry is unbroken at tree level, you can show that there is a general argument that you cannot generate calculus. Only if supersymmetry is broken at a given order, then the tadpole can be added at the next order, right? Again, this is a general result you can prove using supersymmetric coordinates, so which I didn't discuss. That's the reason why this is 0. Yeah, this is 0 because of this. I mean, you have to say that this is the chain. That there is no three-point function of any physical field with these other fields. Because this is hardly not obvious, right? This is something that you have to prove using conformal field theory, various conformal field theory, whatever. Okay. In fact, a stronger condition is true here, okay, which in fact makes life somewhat simpler for us. What you can show is that the projection operator P, so this is the projection operator. To a 0 plus equal to 0 state. Projection operator P acting on and this axiom are acting on . So this basically means that not only that the matrix element of this with any physical state is 0, but the matrix element of this individual with any L0 plus equal to 0 state is 0. And physical state of course have to have L0 plus equal to 0. Okay? So this is helpful because now it gives you a way to integrate this. So you get psi 2 equal to L0 plus times minus half is for the L0 plus non-zero, but this is not quite correct. So okay, let me write the full form that we had written earlier. Okay. So this was going to be minus D0 plus over L0 plus 1 minus E. Okay. And then plus there will be a phi 2. Okay. This phi 2 satisfies P phi 2 equal to phi 2 and QB phi 2. QB phi 2 would have been minus P on this. Okay, if you remember the full definition of what phi 2 was, QB phi 2. This basically solves for the equation of motion in the sector that is projected to be. Projected to L0 plus equal to 0. But in this case, this is 0. This is 0 because of this condition. It's 0 because of these conditions. Okay? This is what that's a qb5 to okay? Otherwise, qb5 would have been minus of this one. So this guy suggests that you should take phi 2 equal to 0. Right? But that's actually not quite true because that will not even agree with the first order solution. Right? We have taken psi 1 to be beta gs 3 1. Right? This is an s0 plus equal to 0 state. Okay? So you shouldn't take phi 2 equal to 0. We should take phi 2 equal to. We should take phi 2. Yes, at least, because the first order solution should be destroyed, right? The first order solution should be there. Because these are fully of order gs square. Okay, so put the gs square back to something. Now, here you have a choice of adding additional order gs square contribution, which is a linear combination of the marginal of dimensions of triangles. Right? That's what we had seen earlier, that when you solve for the psi iteratively, at every order you have a choice of adding arbitrary linear combination of dimensions of triangles. Okay? Those are the parameters that you introduce and they may get fixed later on. Okay? So you could have added linear combination of other primaries, okay, but we just choose not to do it. Okay, and the reason that we choose not to do it is because we will be able to solve the equation at least to the x order without adding anything here. Okay, but it may happen that when you go to sufficiently high order, you find that unless you add something there, it doesn't satisfy the equation. Okay, but our goal will be to solve the equation to next order. Okay, and to next order at least we will see that you can get y without adding anything. See, whatever you add here, provide you extra parameters, right? That you could adjust and try to solve the equations at higher order. Okay, that was the procedure that you had described, right? That every order you have a freedom of adding some terms to the solution, which are just dimension zero primaries with arbitrary coefficients. And those could be fixed in principle at higher order. Right? If they are not fixed, they are bottleneck. Okay? But in this case, from hindsight, we will not add anything here. Because tomorrow we will see that at the next order, so we can still solve the equation without adding. Okay. But we will also see that beta gets fixed at the next order. Okay. Unlike in this order where beta remain unfixed, okay. At the next order, not all beta are allowed.
If for new word we have taken some other linear combination. Instead
yes.
Of mu plus mu star.
Yes.
These conditions will.
Yes, the one is as long as it's a phase, only if you. Because there's a phase rotation symmetry anyway, right? So you could have taken to be equally I alpha nu plus equally minus I alpha nu star. Then it would have given the same. Okay, you have to make sure that it's a real field because you can only get active expressions as real fields, right? Otherwise, this, it will be a complex solution, right? We don't want complex solutions. But you could take it to the I alpha nu plus it to the I alpha nu square. That basically corresponds to in the effective field theory language, taking phi to be to the I alpha times.
Why are you neglecting the pure gauge fields inside the sides?
Oh, because I want to solve psi 2 in some gauge, right? I could keep adding pure gauge states. Those will give the solution in another gauge. So this is what is called the Siegel gauge. Right? You try to have every order, right? You try to make sure that E0 plus annihilate psi 2, you may not be able to ensure it for all levels. Right? But at least L0 plus not equal to 0 levels, right? You may try to ensure that E0 plus annihilate psi 2. For phi 2, of course, you have no choice. Right? That phi 2 you have to solve this equation, right? And you may not find a solution which is annihilated by E0 plus. So this you are imposing just as a gauge quantity, right? But it's not necessary. You could keep adding pure gauge states, and you'll then just get a solution in the effect gauge.
How do spurious poles and spurious singularity show up in the worksheet description?
In the worksheet description, the worksheet correlation function basically diverges, right? Because yeah, spurious poles in fact show up first in the worksheet description, right? That when you write down the worksheet correlation function from the xi's and etas and equally phi's, right? We see that there's a denominator with theta delta, right? Which and whenever that vanishes, the you get singularities, and that denominator is not coming from any OP singularity. Right? It's a completely, arbitrary position, right? It couldn't have guessed the positions by seeing how which operator is considered.